right now. A snitch move, that's what I don't like now.
Broadcasting live from the Armada FM studios in Atlanta, Georgia. This is the Sports Chalk Show with Wayne Gandy.
Welcome. It's Monday. The Sports Chalk is here. He's a couple of people short. But if you know the Sports Chalk, he's always willing to go by himself. I'm here. My two other co-hosts. One is sick. Get well soon. The other is chasing their career in film. We'll see where that goes. That's all I got to say about that. But the tall lady is here. She is always willing to sit in with the Sports Jock. Good morning to you.
Good morning,
Miss Benita. How are you?
I'm good. I'm good. Excited to be here this morning,
and
as always.
I thank you for taking the time to sit down and talk to the Sports Jock this morning. I just need anybody to talk to. I was going to bring the mannequin out, but Nancy Sinatra doesn't really talk to me. And I just didn't want to be stuck with the bad producer all day. I had bad dreams. I was hoping you came because I knew he was going to volunteer to be my sounding board. And that show would have lasted like 17 minutes. And then it would have been white noise the rest of the time. But thank you for coming in. The Sports Jock is here. A great week of sport. Tragedy all around. So before we get into that kind of tone, let's talk about something unexpected of the week.
Okay.
Just something light. We got to start off light. Cat Williams slapping the Target employee.
Lord.
You know, we're going to get to sports in a second. We got eggs thrown at buses. We got some suicide. We got a groundskeeper hanging himself. We got a lot of things in sport.
Yes.
So we got to start off the morning. It's 10 o'clock in the morning. You got to have a happy moment.
Okay.
If you haven't seen this video of comedian Cat Williams slapping this Target employee, you must take your coffee break if you're at work. It takes about 5 minutes. It's only about 35, 40 seconds. But it is the most classic thing that you ever want to see. It's almost remarkable that, because as soon as you see the video, and if you've ever been to Target, you know most of the things in Target are red. So in their little cubicles when they check you out are known around the world. So it's Target. And then you see the employee, the checkout guy.
Okay.
And it seems like Kat is leaving for some reason. He's walking away. And they get in a debate. And you have to make sure you pay close attention because it happens real quick, about the 22-second mark. It's a quick slap comes out. So, you know, pull up your computers. We're going to broadcast it as soon as the good producer. He got a lot of hats today with our co-host being out. He's if you know the good producer, he's going to die about 62 of a heart problem because he stresses a lot. Now, he looks young. He's 48, and he looks about 32 because he's only 5'8", but he stresses a lot.
5'8" for real.
Yeah, him and Cat Williams had. Well, Cat's about 5'4". He's a small man, Cat.
Mm-hmm.
His perm is longer than him.
Yes.
So, but you got to go and check this out because it is just a classic cut. It's funny, and when he slaps this guy about the 22-second mark, he slaps him and steps back. That's the part, like, he's ready. And if you ever seen Cat Williams in real life, you know he might be a buck 38, you know, if anything. But
he's not a buck. I don't think he's 100. I don't think he's 100 pounds.
Now, the part about the story that is truly funny is that he runs out and he gets away on an electric cart. This was his getaway vehicle. So he takes the electric cart to his three-wheel motorcycle, and that was his getaway trip. But, man, to be sitting in jail, I know he's going to – I mean, it's video.
Yes.
And I'm quite sure that Target, you can't – you have to press charges. You can't have people coming in to your building. I wonder – but my thing when I'm watching this, is this Black Friday? Maybe this was Black Friday, and the guy just wouldn't give him – the deal.
No, this is just a black man on a Friday. No, it's not, I don't think it's a Black Friday thing. I think it's a Cat Williams on just any day of the week on 10. He's always on 10. I don't understand him. He seems to be reaching for something because lately he's been incident after incident. You know, just a while back, he and what's the other guy, the comedian, they got into an argument. The big guy that plays in Friday.
Big Worm. Faison Love.
He pulled a gun on Faison Love in a parking lot. And then he says, "I'm a little guy. You seen Faison Love. You seen him. You know, you seen him." And he's like making himself to be, right, you know, the victim in a way. But I think he's reaching for some attention. He's following a really, really, really bad path.
He's classic short man syndrome.
I don't think this is going to end well. He needs some jail time. Maybe he want to be a rapper. That's what it is.
He might want to be a rapper. But sit back. The Sports Jock here. We're live. Me and the tall lady. We're going to let the bad producer even chime in here and there.
Yeah.
We have a great show. NFL. We're going to talk about that coming up next. NBA. Sekou Smith. We got a lot to talk about today. We'll be back after this with more of the Sports Jock Show.
More of the Sports Jock Show with Wayne Gandy coming up next.
It was real. Like, it was real.
7,000 high school students drop out every school day. If you stack their desks one atop the other, it's a pile more than 17,000 feet high. That's 12 Empire State Buildings. But what's truly scary is that another stack is going up tomorrow. We can keep students in school. Visit boostup.org and take the first step. Brought to you by the U.S. Army and the Ad Council.
While cutting molding with a 12-inch dual compound miter saw, while holding a newborn baby in your arms, when face-to-face with a congregation of alligators, with the ball in your hands and the entire freaking season on the line.
There are a million places you'd never consider texting, so why would you do it while driving? NASCAR driver Casey Kane here, asking you to please stop the text, and together we can stop the wrecks.
Brought to you by the Ad Council and the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration. Get the message at stoptextstopwrecks.org.
Sassy! Sassy!
This week's episode, Rattlesnake at the Pond.
Oh, Johnny, skipping rocks at the pond sure is fun.
Hey, look, a moving stick.
That ain't a stick. That's a rattlesnake.
Sassy, we're in danger.
Good idea, Sassy. Go get Mr. Gunderson. You will in a second, but first you'd like to tell us something we may not know about animal shelters in the United States?
It's getting close, Sassy!
Approximately 8 million pets enter shelters each year? The majority of which are in shelters because of owner-related issues that the animals have no control over?
Sassy, the rattlesnake! Save us, Sassy!
What, Sassy? You wish you were videotaping this? Sassy!
Sassy is brought to you by the Ad Council and the ShelterPetProject.org. Remember, adopt.
And now, back to the Sports Jock, Wayne Gandy.
Scoreboard, where we put a spin on life and sports and how they intermingle. On the Sports Jock Show with Wayne Gandy.
Welcome back to the Sports Jock Show. I'm the Sports Jock, Wayne Gandy. NFL Week 13 almost in the book tonight. Monday Night Football. The Redskins against the Giants in Washington. RG3's first night on Monday night. I'm quite sure he's going to have many more. The rookie quarterback is lighting it up this year. Andrew Luck, we're going to talk about his game-winning performance. Russell Wilson, just some great rookie quarterback play in the 2012 season. Before we get to that, the week started on Thursday night, and I think it was a prelude, what was going on, just to set up the whole weekend. It's been a crazy week, as I said, and most of you know about the Kansas City Chiefs incident. But on Thursday night, the Saints invaded the Georgia Dome in one of the heated rivalries in the NFL. The Saints landing here Wednesday night about 8 o'clock. I played for both teams, so I know the rivalry well. When they landed at Hartsfield, is it still Hartsfield-Jackson?
Yes, it is.
Okay, Hartsfield-Jackson. You know they got that new terminal, so it's a couple of names out there. Hartsfield-Jackson Airport out on the tarmac. And for a lot of you that don't know sports teams, we fly in and we land. It's probably, especially in the NFL, it's charter. Sometimes NBA and Major League Baseball, they might own their own planes. But in the NFL, it's charter flights. We land. The buses usually are out on the tarmac. We get off the plane, get on the buses. Well, the Saints landed, and they got on their buses, as they're supposed to. And one of the Hartsfield-Jackson employees that they say was dressed in black and had on a black apron, I think they're trying to help the people search for the person, decided that they were going to egg the Saints. They threw eggs at the Saints bus. Now, tall lady, this is my thing. We all know here, especially after 9/11, airports have a lot of cameras, and it's a lot of security. Let's come on now.
Yes.
I mean, they got all kind of different probes and screening tests and wands, and you know, you, at the airport as an employee, you have to sign in, so they know who's at work.
Yes,
they know. And if you're in an apron, it's only so many people that have access to eggs. And I'm figuring, you know, I'm not a bright man. I haven't discovered the cure for cancer, but I'm figuring you probably work in the restaurant area because you had some eggs. So when did you come up with this plan of I'm going to take a dozen eggs and I'm going to go out and I'm going to lose my job now?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm going to lose my job because we're talking about the airport. You can't even really say much on the plane. You know, can't move real fast. They might put you off and ban you. I'm going to go out and I'm going to throw eggs at a team bus.
National security at its best.
So this guy is going to go to jail, and this is what he's probably, when they find him, I'm quite sure, because they say we're laughing, but the general manager and the security team at the airport, they are not laughing at this at all, and they shouldn't be, because this time it's eggs, how our society is going, the next time it's a gun.
Yes, but my problem with this guy is not the fact that he, I mean, all the things, the security parts, that's bad. But he is a supposed Falcons fan.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking about the fact you're throwing eggs. Could that have possibly been baby Falcons that you're throwing? that is really not cool. I was thinking, you know, it's almost like throwing baby Falcons at a team,
right,
you know, to disgrace them. You're actually throwing what I thought would symbolize the youth, the infancy of your program.
Right.
And you know, get real deep about it.
Now, I have, throughout my high school and collegiate career, when I was in high school, our rivalry, I'm from Haines City, Florida. Our rivalry is a team called Lake Wales, which is about 10 miles from Haines City, Lake Wales, is where Amari Stoudemire is from, the power forward for the New York Knicks. So it was a heated rivalry, and this is high school. So some of the kids, like you know, takes pranks. They would egg our bus coming into the town. So sometimes we even had to lay down in the seat, especially if we won. You had to kind of lay down on the school bus so they wouldn't see your head. Or we would come out there, and they had put sugar in the tank. So we got to sit there and wait on them to send another school bus or something like that. When I was in college, we played University of Florida, and they would throw AAA batteries, a little small battery. So yes, we would have to keep our helmet on when we played them because, the rowdy yes fans, they would bring the little small batteries and throw them at us. Even in Tennessee, I played one time. They would throw little orange wedges at you when you came out for introduction. So I'm used to that. But in the pro level, I had never really seen that. You know, and when you drive in, they usually shoot a bird, you know, because some of those places have great tailgating. So you drive through the tailgate, and they flip you off real quick. And,
okay,
you know,
why don't you think that people who will take time to paint their bodies in zero-degree weather or, you know, with low temperatures, that they would not result to other ignorance? I mean,
well, at least in those situations, they're at the actual game. This guy is at his job.
I think he thought he was going to get some tickets out of this thing. Probably like, the Falcons going to be so proud of me. There's going to be somebody that's going to come down right to the airport looking for me to give me some tickets. I'm going to get season tickets to the Falcons. I'm thinking, yes, you're just throwing baby Falcons at the darn bus.
Baby Falcons.
He must have didn't get the memo, because the day before he was off work, they had just caught someone's girlfriend throwing lunch over the fence at Hartsfield Jackson.
Throwing lunch over the fence.
She threw her boyfriend's. He forgot to get his lunch. She went to the airport.
What kind of lunch can you throw over the fence? What is that?
Like, but that's why everybody's like, this guy must didn't get the memo that security was even on a high alert, because the fact the lady had approached the fence, threw the lunch over the fence. This was the day before, and then you had this incident with the eggs.
Right, and I did. I went over to the Saints hotel and picked up one of my friends, Dwayne, and I asked him about it. And he said, yeah, it was true that they had egged the bus. And they never felt like they were in danger, but it was kind of, you hear the thumping noise when the eggs hit the bus. That's very,
it's disheartening. I think it's disheartening, too, because you're thinking somebody is on the tarmac throwing eggs, what's next? Mm. Because if this person is not being secured or taken off, now, when you really get to the serious side of it, I understand the threat, and I understand why people would see it as a little bit bigger than just a prank.
Right.
This is an international airport.
Yes. So, and I'm just happy that at least if there are any bright side to this, at least he didn't throw it at an actual player as they were walking, because you might have to walk like 20, 30 yards to get to the buses. So at least he didn't, waiting till they got on the bus, he didn't seem like he wanted to hurt any of them. The Saints did lose to the Falcons 23-13 on Thursday night. The Falcons, now 11-1, have wrapped up the NFC South. So they have won their division and are poised. I think if they win two more games, they will wrap up home field advantage throughout the playoffs. They've been in that situation before and lost to the Packers. Hopefully this time they've learned their lessons and can win a playoff game. I think everybody, at least here in Atlanta, still has a little doubt, because they're going to have to win a playoff game, which they haven't done under Coach Smith. And he's had some great seasons before. He needs to win a game in the playoffs, him and Matt Ryan.
The little engine that could.
We got a different team this year.
I think I can.
We have a different team this year?
We got a different team.
Why? Because Julio Jones cut his hair?
No, just because of the fact that with the injuries on defense, and seeing these guys step up, and the defensive part of it, the defense has stepped up. If you're a true Falcons fan, the last 10 years, the Falcons have averaged over 20 points a game. The defense has just given up over 20 points.
Right.
So now I think that with Mike Nolan, I mean, it's a whole different look and a whole different team out there right now. So I mean, I'm.
So are you a true Falcon fan?
True Falcon fan. Super Bowl. Okay. Super Bowl.
You know how you switch as the player starts.
No.
I have a confession, man. I have a confession.
You are not a true Falcon fan.
I am a sometimes Falcons fan. I am a Falcons fan until they play the Saints. I grew up in Mississippi. I was born in Louisiana. I was a Saints fan when they were the Aints, when people were wearing brown paper bags over their heads.
Was that you?
I was never ashamed of being a Saints fan. I didn't know as much about football. They were just a terrible team, but that was my home team. So I grew up 55 miles from New Orleans.
Who was the running back for the Saints in the 80s?
I don't know.
Oh, okay.
I just like their uniform.
Oh, I know. And I thought maybe you knew Chuck Muncy, you know.
I don't know none of them people.
He's probably the best Aints ever.
You know what? Stop.
So can you speak that Louisiana language they speak?
Creole.
Yeah, whatever. Yeah, that thing they talk when they, hey, baby, and
baby,
all that.
Baby, you don't know nothing.
That ain't how Lil Wayne said.
We ain't going to do you nothing, okay?
You heard that new Lil Wayne song?
No
Worries.
That is a disgusting song.
Awesome.
But
why?
Because
he tells the woman she ain't shaved.
Well,
is that the part that
you know what? I don't care nothing about none of that. It's just the fact. It's just the fact that what he talking about. I don't want my child to sing the darn song. That's all. That's my problem.
Well, we don't have any worries around here about who is in the house. We got the tall lady. I'm happy to have the tall lady here with me.
Glad to be here.
No, not you, Bad Producer. We'll be back after this for more of the Sports Jock Show.
More of the Sports Jock Show with Wayne Gandy coming up next.
So, Jacqueline.
Yes, Mom?
I wanted to talk to you about something, and... Oh, wait. Hold on. I just got a text. Oh, there's another one. Wow. Busy, busy me. So, anyway...
Oh, wait, Mom. I just got a message. My friends keep commenting on my comment. Oh, there's another one. So many comments on my comment.
Oh, I can't wait to watch TV tonight. Playoffs!
Hey, guys, check out my new video game. Pew, pew!
Wait.
Mom, what?
Huh? What? Hold on.
What'd you say?
Wait a second, what?
This weekend, unplug. Take your family to the forest. There's nothing in the world like experiencing nature firsthand. Trees, paths, bluebirds, streams. Getting closer to nature can get you closer to your family. To find the forest nearest you, go to discovertheforest.org. Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.
Hey, over here.
What?
Right here, on the side of the house.
Who said that?
Look down. I'm right at your feet.
Wait, the basketball?
Yes, the basketball. Right down here, where the kids left me a long time ago. Man, you know how lonely it is being a ball and not being able to bounce or roll?
Excuse me?
Remember what you got me for the kids? You said, now kids, you have no excuse not to go outside and play.
Uh-huh.
Wow. I'll miss flying through the air and hearing the shouts of joy when I swish through the basket. What do you say? Could you give me a little air and remind the kids of how fun I still am?
Okay. Oh, wow. You are flat.
Easy. I'm ticklish. Let's get bouncing.
As Native American parents and caregivers, our encouragement to healthy lifestyles for our kids is helping them get outside and play. Get ideas. Get involved. Get going at letsmove.gov/IndianCountry. Brought to you by USDA, HHS, and the Ad Council.
And now, back to the Sports Jock, Wayne Gandy.
I ain't got no worries. I ain't got no worries. See, them strummers keep me up. So I ain't got no worries. I ain't got no worries. I ain't got no worries. You see money right there.
Welcome back to the Sports Jock Show. He said them shrooms got him up. I ain't got no worries. That's Lil Wayne. No worries. Welcome back to the show. Stick around in the next segment. We're going to talk to Dr. Tom Fierro, clinical and sports psychologist. We're going to address this Kansas City Chief linebacker, Javon Belcher, who murdered suicide this weekend. When it comes up, very, very sad, 25 years old. You can reach out at us, 888-926-7562. With any questions or comments, Also, we have that Cat Williams video up. If you want to go online to sportsjock.com, it's only going to be 36 seconds, so you don't have to take a lot of time. But at the 22-second mark, that's when the slap happens. But check that out. We do have a call on the line. Mike, are you there?
Yes, yes. Good morning, Sports Jock. How are you?
And we have the weather report. It is sunny outside and breezy. No, Mike, go ahead.
Yes, I had a question or a comment, basically. Two-part question. Why is it, you know, like you stated, you know, everyone's around the league, around Atlanta, the country is expecting the Falcons to win a playoff game to finally get any respect. My question to you is, why is it that the Falcons still can't get any respect around the league, even after beating their nemesis, their number one rival, who are their division rivals? So, you know, they, like the media has been saying, okay, they need to blow out the Saints to prove to me that they warrant they're going to go somewhere and make it to the Super Bowl. But, I mean, this is a division game. The two teams know each other. They play twice a year. How is it expected for the Saints to get blown out by the Falcons?
Well, that's a good question. One thing is, in this country, especially in the sports world, it's not just good enough to win anymore. It seems like you have to win with a certain style. Just winning 23-20, well, yeah, you won. That's how people say it in regards to winning. They think that if you're supposed to be dominant, everything is supposed to be a blowout. The Falcons, as I said, have won their division. They're 11-1. They have four games left. They're poised to be NFC champs regular season and have a bye throughout the playoffs. Yes, they have won a lot of games in the last closing seconds. But when you take the field and you're a true professional, all you want is at the end of the day that I won. A player doesn't go in a game thinking we need to blow these people out. You go in the game trying to figure out how we can win the game and get to the next game and get to the next level. The Falcons have already secured that they're going to the playoffs. They have no problem with that. And they're going to have a first-round bye. So their next step in their mind is to try to stay healthy, still win some games, because you don't want anything at the end where you got a lot of play. You want to get to that last game where you can kind of rest some players. That's one thing. So their next goal is to wrap up home field advantage throughout the playoffs. And once they establish that, it doesn't matter. If you hold up that Lombardi trophy, it doesn't matter whether you won by 200 points or 2 points. Yeah. You're still the Super Bowl champs. And I think that that's just more of the society thing. You're supposed to do impress people. I thought winning was impressing, Tali.
I think that when professionals are playing professionals, the expectation that someone would blow someone out to me is ridiculous.
Right.
I think that the game should be well matched. I mean, I know that drafting and building teams are not going to be the same caliber player on every team. But when you have professionals playing professionals, I would still believe that the games, in order to be competitive and to really enjoy them, you would want it to be a good grudge match. You want it to go back and forth. You want, I mean,
right.
Yes, if I'm on one team, though, I do want to whoop somebody's butt. You know, I really do. But just as a fan, I want a good game.
Yeah.
I want to really enjoy it. I want, give me a reason to stay there and watch, not a reason to get up and leave in the second quarter or the third quarter and say, I need to see the rest of this.
Right, because it's more satisfying when you win a game through a struggle. I mean, as a competitor, yeah, we all hope to knock somebody in the first round, knock them out. Yeah. But trust me, if you go 8, 9, 10 rounds and you leave there like, oh, this man, I was close to losing at the edge and yes. I came through. There is that confidence and that pride that is built through I had to really work for a win. I just found out why Big Kenny was sick and throwing up this morning.
Uh-oh.
For all of you that may not know,
you can say
that Jets game yesterday against the Cardinals would make anybody sick.
Lucky dogs.
J-E-T-S, Jets.
Yes.
Do we really miss that this morning?
No, we don't miss that. They won a game yesterday 7-6 over the Cardinals. They finally benched Mark Sanchez in the third quarter. And the backup quarterback came in and threw the only touchdown, the seventh. And it was an ugly game. And I think this is why. He called, left a message, said he had been throwing up for about 8 hours. Oh, and I'm thinking probably that was at the conclusion of the game.
I do have a question, though.
What's that? Jack.
Was that a insult to Wildcat Jesus not to put him in as for them to overlook him and to go with this kid, the rookie?
I think that Wildcat Jesus was never going to be the second guy in. I always thought that they really got him in for that specific Wildcat position, and they were always going to go to Greg McElroy. But Big Kenny, get well soon between your Jets. And I thought my Auburn Tigers sucked. Southern Miss went 0-12.
They were 12-2 last year. How do you flip that?
I don't know. Oh, and they fired the coach, though. We'll be back. Dr. Tom Fierro, talk about Kansas City Chiefs tragedy right after this.
More of the Sports Jock Show with Wayne Gandy coming up next.
I don't believe it. My savings are gone. They're gone.
You're kidding.
Nope, they're gone. They're gone.
Okay, all right. Think about it. Where did you have them last?
I remember I was home, then I took them, and then I spent them on that vacation to Aruba. Then I bought this miniature suit of armor I saw in the in-flight magazine.
And that's the last you saw of your savings?
Yes.
This is so weird.
I know, right?
Weird? Not really. Not saving now means no money later. You'd be surprised how quickly a little money from every paycheck can really add up. Put away a few bucks, feel like a million bucks. For free ideas and easy ways to save, go to feedthepig.org.
The armor is cool, though. Oops. I think I broke its gauntlet.
You broke my favorite part.
This message brought to you by the American Institute of Certified Public Accountants and the Ad Council.
Kids have the craziest ideas about food. Where do they get this stuff? Like eating Brussels sprouts helps you hit home runs. And eating carrots gives you X-ray vision. It's nuts. And I honestly have no idea where my daughter got this notion that broccoli is the official food of professional ballerinas. Kids, the only reason my 4-year-old loves cantaloupe is because he's convinced it comes from the moon.
One small step for man, lots of potassium for mankind.
And the other day when my oldest came up to me and said, "Mom, will eating peas and carrots really help me pull off a fakie frontside ollie with a twist?" I look him in the eye and say, "It can't hurt, honey. It can't hurt."
Moms everywhere are finding creative ways to help their kids eat 5 servings of fruit and vegetables a day. Get ideas, get involved, get going at letsmove.gov. Brought to you by the USDA, HHS, and the Ad Council.
While cutting molding with a 12-inch dual compound miter saw, while holding a newborn baby in your arms, when face-to-face with a congregation of alligators, with the ball in your hands and the entire freaking season on the line.
There are a million places you'd never consider texting, so why would you do it while driving? NASCAR driver Casey Kane here, asking you to please stop the text, and together we can stop the wrecks.
Brought to you by the Ad Council and the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration. Get the message at stoptextstopwrecks.org.
And now, back to the Sports Jot, Wayne Gandy.
Welcome back to the Sports Jock Show. I'm the Sports Jock, Wayne Gandy. Tragedy in Kansas City. There is no easy way to report this story, as most of the country knows now. 25-year-old linebacker Javon Belcher, murder-suicide. He murdered his girlfriend. They had a 3-month-year-old daughter. He murdered her about 8 a.m. He then drove over to the Kansas City Chiefs practice facility, in which he thanked general manager Scott Pioli and his coach Romeo Crennel to thank them for all they had done for him. He then turned the gun on himself, and that wound killed him. Sad story, 25 mm-hmm. years old. No matter where I went for the last 2 days, people are mystified. I guess more so because, like a lot of people, they think that if you have money, what else could you have going wrong in your life? This kid, just real quickly, we have Dr. Tom Fierro, clinical and sports psychologist, on the line. But just to bring you up to date, the girlfriend supposedly had gone to a concert, got in a little late. Argument started 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning. No reports on how long it lasted, but it carried on until that morning at 8 a.m. in which he shot her. His mom, who was in to watch the game from New York, was actually in the house. She's the one who called 911. He drove over to the facility. Coach and the GM pleaded for him not to do what he eventually did. The Chiefs did take the field yesterday. They could have opted out of playing. That's one thing a lot of people don't realize. You think these guys won't just go perform. They did win 27-21, their second win of the season. But in this country, as you see, even when I picked up the paper today, man in Connecticut killed his father, a woman, and himself. So I have said many times before, tall lady, that it seems that murder-suicide, it's almost monthly, yes, that you see this kind of thing happening.
It's weekly.
Yeah, it's a big thing. So I wanted to know and reach out to someone I thought maybe could put us in the mind of how this person really thinks at that time. Dr. Fierro, are you there?
I'm here. Good morning.
Good morning to you. Thank you for calling in, and thank you for calling in again. I know the last time we spoke, I think it was on something like tattoos. So here,
very interesting stuff, right?
Yeah, here it's the murder-suicide. As I said, not only did this happen Saturday in the world of sports, it happened Friday in Connecticut with a family. And it wasn't a murder-suicide, but at the Cleveland Brown facility, the groundskeeper, he hung himself.
Wow.
In the building, in the equipment room somewhere in the shed. If you could just help us and take all the time you need to explain, try to put us in the mind of is it a depression? What sends you, first of all, to feel like you need to kill yourself along with the person?
Well, okay, obviously important question, good question. There's two, I think probably two components to this on the surface at least. One is, like you said, the last part of the question, what leads someone to the suicide aspect. That has to do mostly with guilt. What leads to the murder aspect, that total rage, and is it connected to depression? My general sense about the story, if I look at it, at least on a kind of a superficial basis, here we have a kid who is very talented. The way I've read about him, how he's been described, is a very conscientious, the front room, so always like he, you know, always in the front row when he's at practice, very attentive, very competitive, very neat. So when you begin to add this up, the clinical psychologists begin to think about questions of obsessive compulsive traits or obsessive compulsive personality. What this is someone who is very perfectionistic, demanding on himself and others. Many, many athletes are this way. Otherwise, there's no way they could ever get to the level that they're at unless they're very hardworking, conscientious, perfectionistic. Okay? So you have that. The second aspect of the story that comes to my mind is the massive amount of pressure that any professional athlete is under. In this case, it's the NFL. A lot of money, a lot of fame. You have this kind of ingredient that adds pressure to the situation. Third element, the toxic nature of any professional sports where they have to travel and leave home, always staying in hotels, being away from home. This is very difficult for any marriage. When you add these things up together, then all you need is some kind of a trigger point. In this case, it was some difficulty in the marriage. She's out late. She may be a little dissatisfied. I don't know what her circumstances are. But it sounds like a small spat that turned into as a trigger point. But as analysts and psychoanalysts, we look at the underlying kind of dynamics that produce this story and this action. And of course, the very sad part of this is that rather than having a person go to someone and figure it out, talk it out, think it out, there's a propensity to act, right? In this case, obviously, act out anger with violence. This is such a sad, sad story. It sounds like he was a great kid, probably a wonderful girlfriend he had. You know, very, very sad story. And, obviously, that's why it's in all the papers, the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, Newsday up here on Long Island. Everyone is covering this and, trying to comprehend what just happened.
Well, Doc, we're going to take a quick break. I don't want to get you into the next question. We're going to go to break. We're talking to Dr. Tom Fierro, clinical and sports psychologist, Javon Belcher, linebacker, Kansas City Chiefs, murder-suicide. His girlfriend was 22 years old. They had a three-month-year-old daughter. Very sad story, as I said. Chiefs still went out, played a game, played a great game, won the game. We'll talk more to Dr. Fierro when we come back. 888-926-7562. The Sports Jock will be back right after this.
More of the Sports Jock Show with Wayne Gandy coming up next.
Hi, we're talking to real smokers about quitting. Tell me when you smoke and why you smoke.
Eat, cigarette, kids, cigarette, dinner, another cigarette.
One on my way to lunch, one after lunch.
And another cigarette, and another cigarette.
Have you tried to quit?
Yes. I become angry.
It ain't that easy. You can't just quit cold turkey. I tried.
What would you do different?
Actually having a plan and thinking it through.
You have to relearn how to live your life without a cigarette in your hand.
With the right plan, you can quit smoking. Free at becomeanx.org. X, a new way to think about quitting. Brought to you by X and the Ad Council.
Dave, what are you doing?
Just sending a gift to Dave 2037.
Who?
Me in the future. I save a little money from every paycheck as a gift to Dave 2037, so he can spend it on things like anti-gravity boots or a hologram Doberman. Something cool like that. I think Dave 2037 deserves it. He worked hard. What are you getting Steve 2037?
I guess I was thinking Steve 2037 would just fend for himself.
Well, all right, but don't expect to be borrowing my anti-gravity boots.
You want to have money in your future? You got to start saving now. Putting some money from every paycheck into a savings account or contributing to your 401k can make a big difference later. Put away a few bucks, feel like $1 million. For free ideas and easy ways to save, go to feedthepig.org. That's
feedthepig.org.
Hey, let's just hope Steve 2037 doesn't get his hands on a cold time machine, because he is going to come back here and knock some sense into you.
This message brought to you by the American Institute of Certified Public Accountants and the Ad Council.
And now, back to the Sports Jock, Wayne Gandy.
There's a fire starting in my heart, reaching a fever pitch, and it's bringing me out the dark. Finally, I can see you crystal clear. Go ahead and sell me out, and I'll lay your ship bare.
Welcome back to the Sports Jock Show. I'm the Sports Jock, Wayne Gandy, Kansas City Chiefs linebacker Javon Belcher. Killed his girlfriend, then himself. We're on the line with Dr. Tom Fierro, clinical and sports psychologist. Doc, I guess my next question would be, why do you think he killed her and then he drove to the facility? I think that's what a lot of people, why the facility?
Well, that's an interesting question, right? I mean, my take on it would be that he goes he is in tremendous guilt. So he says goodbye to people that are meaningful to him, and then that makes no difference what they say, that he's still going to then hurt himself, kill himself. So, you know, it's an amazing, you know, that aspect of it. Talking, you know, it brings to mind how damaging this event is for so many people. Belcher's family, Cassandra's family, the young child, the coach and the GM now have post-traumatic stress and guilt. Huge. Mm-hmm. I mean, to witness someone shooting themselves and killing themselves is a very, very traumatic experience. The teammates themselves, if any of them saw that, this is also traumatic. So you have the ripple effect of this is really very, very upsetting and very, very damaging to many, many people.
So the fight, she comes in from the concert, because another, this was something else that jumped off the page. The fight ensues about 1 a.m., but my reaction in a deadly way doesn't happen to 8 in the morning. Yeah. So how does that manifest that it didn't even, you know, because usually, you know, we can fight with anyone, and if you walk away for a couple of hours, that rage leaves you. Even if, you know, you usually come back and you kind of talk out after the big fighting. He still was still in a certain rage that he would commit the murder that morning.
Well, this is a good question. I mean, and it just, to my sense is it gives you a sense of just how upset he was, how enraged he was, how out of control he felt. My guess is that he felt he couldn't control her anymore. She may have been somewhat dissatisfied with things. So this is upsetting kind of, can't resolve it, can't figure it out. No other solution but the action solution, which is not, you know, it's not an unusual phenomena for many, many people to act instead of think and talk, right? This is the basic process of my business, of psychotherapy, helping people to stop acting and start thinking and talking. And it didn't happen in this case.
So when, as a parent, because that is the next person, you know, we know Scott Pioli, the GM, and that is set. But as a parent to sit there and you're in town, you watch your son murder someone. Where is she mentally? When is she trying to protect herself? Is she trying to talk him down? Because she was in his house. Javon Belcher's mother is in the house. What is going through her mind at that time?
Well, she's in a complete state of panic. You know he's probably raging, angry. She's probably trying to talk him down. You know, calm down. It's going to work out. Don't worry about it. I'm here for you. All of it didn't work. So the power of a person's inside, a person's emotional state, a person's neurosis or psychosis, very, very strong. And that's the thing that obviously has to be addressed. And what I always push for is people with, you know, ongoing supportive psychotherapy. I think that every professional athlete should be in therapy for one simple reason: the level of pressure that these guys are under, the amount of travel they have to do, the amount of exhaustion and physical pain they go through, the amount of money they make. All of this is way, way too overwhelming, and so you need this kind of a support system to help control the emotions. And when you don't have the support system, this, you know, these kind of things, whether it's massive drug addiction, acting out, domestic violence, this is absolutely predictable. You know, they live in a very, very difficult, highly, highly stressed and highly public world.
One thing that happened, and real quickly, the word that I have some friends that play for the Chiefs is that the girlfriend went to a Trey Songz. He's a singer, R&B guy. She was pulled up on the stage. Some of his teammates text him and called him and ridiculed him for her going up in this stage. Now, is that really that trigger point that you were talking about?
Oh, it's got to be. I mean, that's if he felt in many ways humiliated, embarrassed, you know, laughed at, public humiliation. It's a very, 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 very angering, raging kind of process. That may be. I mean, I don't know the details if she's on stage and she's probably having basically a harmless fun time, but that's a different kettle of fish when you think of either a husband or a serious boyfriend who's actually trying to have a relationship with this person, you know. So, yeah, that you're right. I mean, the trigger point is right there. The shame, the humiliation, oh, my God, what, I can't believe that this is happening to me kind of thing. You know, very, it's called narcissistic injury, meaning that someone who's at the high level in a public arena wants to feel, you know, people like him and are proud of him, and when you have this kind of humiliation, it's a very, very enraging process, not unusual, actually.
Well, Doc, if you can just hold line one more time, I want to talk about just why is it that this seems to be a very prevalent thing across the country, this murder-suicide. Yep. Dr.
Sure.
Tom Fierro, clinical and sports psychologist. We'll be back with more of the Sports Jock Show right after this. 888-926-7562. We'll be back after this.
Listen to the...
More of the Sports Jock Show with Wayne Gandy coming up next.
Everybody, let's go, let's go. Ho, ho, ho. Welcome, everyone, to West High School Spring Fling. Hey, where we at? Where we at?
All right, I've gone through all the tracks. Just move through the beats. Do your thing.
All right, everyone, let's hear it for West High's own Brooke Turner, a.k.a. DJ Hook.
Scratching up my first school dance takes confidence. So we're getting into college. I've got what it takes. Okay, I went through the practice sessions. I slept good. I feel good.
We will now begin the test. Please take out your pencils.
I got this.
We're all good at something. Maybe it's breakdancing or skateboarding or video games. Whatever you're good at, you had the skills to make it happen. And those same skills will help us get to college. Visit knowhowtogo.org to learn what you should be doing right now to prepare for college. Start taking the steps at knowhowtogo.org.
I've got what it takes. So do you.
Brought to you by the American Council on Education, Lumina Foundation, and the Ad Council.
And now, back to the Sports Jock, Wayne Gandy.
You and I go hard at each other like we're going. Welcome back to the Sports Jock Show. I'm the Sports Jock, Wayne Gandy. Great information, and I must say that before we go any further. Dr. Tom Fierro, clinical and sports psychologist. I've gotten four or five texts already. People are definitely engrossed in learning more about this situation. Kansas City Chiefs linebacker Javon Belcher kills his girlfriend, drives to the facility, kills himself in front of the coaches and the GM. The team takes the field yesterday against the Panthers, 27-21, their second win. It's ironic how the mind works. Tragedy seems to breed a certain focus, as you even saw earlier this year with Baltimore Ravens wide receiver Troy Smith. He goes out, his brother gets killed. 12 hours later, he was able to go out and have a big game. So, Torrey Smith, for the Baltimore Ravens. Dr. Fierro, just before we let you go, and we appreciate you taking your time, one thing in this country, as I said when we started this, the murder-suicide thing seems to be gaining momentum. Is there any triggers of why that is so?
Well, 2 points. One, just speaking to what you mentioned about tragedy breeds focus, I think there's some truth to that, probably very under-researched. I remember Buster Douglas lost his father, and then he beats Mike Tyson. You hear this story in golf many times. Ben Crenshaw wins the Masters after he loses his swing coach. So this is kind of an interesting sidelight. However, in answer to the question, what is this? It's an interesting question. You're pulling the two things together, murder and suicide, but in fact they're very much the same thing. They're all about violence. So one is violence acted out to the other, and the other is violence acted out to the self. So suicide, obviously, you're violently attacking yourself. So it's basically two sides of the same coin. And the point, of course, is that I mean, America is a very angry place. All of us are stressed. All of us are overworked. You know, this is the country we live in. If you travel to Europe, you see it's a very, very much more relaxed culture. So you have a stressed culture. You have an angry culture. This is why people overeat. They take drugs, et cetera, et cetera. And so there has to be, you know, really what we need is a whole cultural shift, which I think will eventually happen. And for the time being, when you have this kind of anger that's building up, of course, what you want to recommend is that people don't hold it in, but really find a confidant, someone who, a mentor, a psychologist, anyone, a priest, who you can go to and just ventilate. Ventilation means talking about your anger in such a way that it airs itself out. Someone listens, hears your story, and then gives a little bit of feedback. This is so very important. And if he had that, probably this never would have happened. But it, you know, people lead as more and more in America, increasingly private lives, quiet. We just get in the cars, we watch television. There's not a sense of the sharing or a sense of community anymore, and it's such a tragic thing. So,
one thing because the case in Cleveland sparked this question to me in my mind. The groundskeeper for the Cleveland Browns hung himself at the facility as well that same Saturday morning. Does the way you commit the suicide tell the story? And Javon Belcher's, he shot himself. You see people in the news have stabbed themselves to death. You've seen people in the Cleveland Brown case, he hung himself. Does that tell us anything about where they were mentally?
Well, I think so. I mean, I don't know the literature on this, but obviously there's truth to it. In other words, these are more serious attempts, whether it's a gun or a hanging, a stabbing. These are not calls for attention. This is the real stuff. This is really wanting to die. Whereas other methods, there may be a 50-50 chance of death, and therefore it introduces the idea of a call for help. So that in that regard, these are very serious matters, very serious attempt. They know they're going to end their life, and just the literature, the dynamics of suicide is an amazingly horrible thought. I mean, to end a life, you know, to want to feel in so much pain and so unbelievably hopeless that you have to end your life. This is a very, very sad thing, you know, which is a testament to why people need to reach out and share and talk and find a trusted person to communicate with, so that this, of course, another person that's going to be in the world is going to give you more reasonable feedback and always give you encouragement and hope. And, you know, this is, of course, a very important thing, and many people don't have that, so.
Mike, this is the tall lady. I have a quick question.
Sure.
Do you think that social media and the fact that people don't interface with each other as much really makes it easier for folks to hide their emotions, their true emotions, because everybody paints the picture on social media as the happy person or whatever it is? Do you think social media really is not helpful but more of a hindrance to those things?
Well, I think that's a very good question. I think that's a central problem in the modern world, the social media, because I think it's so good, it's so entertaining, it's so interesting in so many ways, and so convenient that it's basically taking over, and it's taking over community. And what that means is that we don't have a sense of community, the third place that you find in Starbucks, et cetera, et cetera. And so when you don't have a sense of community, you fall back unto yourself in a private way, very, very, very isolating, not helpful, and this is one of the big issues in America right now. What does one do about it? You know, how do you foster a sense of community again? You know, I write a column for a local paper for that very reason. It's called Our Town, and all I want to do is kind of help the community look at the storekeepers and get to know each other. That idea, and when you travel overseas, you really see the difference. You really see. Because cities there in Europe are very old, so there's no cars in the middle of them. People walk around, and you see a different life, really. So, yes, it's a very legitimate question, a serious problem. So, you know, like I guess I would say, with all good comes some bad. And so the good of social media, the electronic revolution, brings with it some bad also, which is a sense of isolation, and with that comes all sorts of problems.
Well, Doc, we appreciate you calling in and helping us out. And hopefully the next time we speak, there will be something happy to talk about. We get back on tattoos, maybe. But Dr. Tom Fierro, thank you very much.
Call anytime.
Oh, thank you. We'll be back. Yep. More of the Sports Jock Show. 888-926-7562. Good question, tall lady.
Thank you. Listen to the rebroadcast Saturdays, 1 to 4 p.m. Central on Q90.5, Camden, Alabama.
More of the Sports Jock Show with Wayne Gandy coming up next.
Far from the city, where the Lorax roams free, is the home of the magical truffula trees. In a place you will love, with things you'll adore us, it's a magical spot. We call it the forest.
Everyone here needs the trees.
And who are you?
I'm the Lorax, guardian of the forest.
The forest is there for you to explore. So come once to see it, then come back lots more.
I just like hearing you say it.
Visit discovertheforest.org, brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.
And now, back to the Sports Jock, Wayne Gandy.
Enough is enough! I have had it!
Why so serious?
And we hold the world ransom for...
Wayne Gandy.
Excuse me while I whip this out.
Broadcasting live from the Armada FM studios in Atlanta, Georgia. This is the Sports Jock Show with Wayne Gandy.
Welcome back to the Sports Jock Show. I'm the Sports Jock, Wayne Gandy. We'd like to once again thank Dr. Tom Fierro, clinical and sports psychologist, for helping us with this Kansas City Chiefs linebacker, Javon Belcher. As most of you know, and if you've been listening in, murder-suicide Saturday, girlfriend 22 years old,
sad.
Daughter 3 months. The daughter is only, so she has a hard road ahead of her. Hopefully the mom can really embrace her and take her through this. It's going to take a long time probably for the mom to heal, and this Kansas City Chiefs team. Some points that Dr. Fierro hit. Perfectionist athletes are perfectionists. One thing I can tell women out there, when you a lot of women never understand, you have to date an athlete different than you date other men. You really can say that about everything, just like if you're dating a police officer or a politician. But there is a certain way that an athlete has to be handled. If you're not ready to take on that, and most of that is a selflessness. If you're thinking that it's going to be about you and not about him, you are kidding yourself.
I think that's why we have those basketball wives types of situations.
Yeah, because if you think it's going to be that his world and his mindset is going to be about furthering you, and you're not equally qualified to give him, just like you're saying, you go out, you're on the stage with another man, where you're talking about a man who his whole life desire is to be known as the man. He goes out from first, I want to be the star. I want to be the number one player here. I want to be the first round draft choice. I want to be the all pro. I want to be the highest paid. That is the personality that you're dealing with. He's done everything in his life, every day, to be the best. His competition is standing next to him, behind him. He might be sleeping in the same room with his competition. He knows where he's trying to go and what he's trying to achieve, and he's being weighed and measured his whole life. So when you go out and you do something like that to him, and you put him in this spectrum of, like I always tell women, that's why the first wife, the first girlfriend, you never even heard of, because that's usually who that guy would go find. He's going to go find someone that he, in his mind, and I've had friends that I've played with that might have been playboys, and they'll go marry some 20-year-old girl that they think Well, she's about as close to being a virgin as I can find. And I know no one in this league has ever slept with her. So I don't ever have to worry about being on the team with somebody who's been with my lady, which makes that goes with his personality.
If you put anything
in his way, that's what I'm just trying to get some of y'all to understand, because she was a young girl and he got that call, and I don't know if that's the real trigger point, from his linebacker buddy about, man, I just saw your girl up there with Trey Songz, man. Trey was all on her.
He got that call, and you think about it, man, you looking at the embarrassment. I mean, and you hate to feel that he got that angry that he killed her in front of his mom and everybody. I mean, just the embarrassment. I mean, and it's sad all the way around. Mm-hmm. It's just embarrassing.
And you laugh like, well, how could that be it? Well, you're dealing with a different competitive man. Yeah. You saying like, oh, Trey Songz, but he see Trey Songz as this famous guy that's in the media that got a couple dollars. Why does he get the privilege to rub up on my lady?
Yeah. That's
and
what
you
I
sitting there
thinking
it's a joke. Well, you're not listening to the breed of man I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. This man's whole objective in life is to be first. He's been trained to be first. And if he doesn't get to be first, his whole objective is still to keep pushing the limits. That's why athletes have a hard time in social situations. They drink a lot. They do drugs. When their careers don't go where it wants to go, you find them sleeping under some tree.
Yeah.
Because it was that kind of mentality that they were totally engrossed in. Now, hopefully you have some kind of guidance at home. Hopefully you have some kind of spirituality that can keep you grounded to that doesn't become your total way of thought. But no matter how humble, how much God you are, you know, when people talk about me, I was the 15th pick of the NFL draft. Trust me, that won't ever leave my heart. I was a bad boy, and yes, I know that, but I have the confidence in other areas in my life that I don't have to live that way. But don't think that I don't know in my soul that I was that dude.
Yeah.
And it irritates you when you find yourself in an arena. That's why the guy goes and do something stupid. He wear more gold chains. I'm going to wear 10 gold chains. He got on 11. I'm going to wear 12. He got on 13. I'm going to wear 14. You know, I'm going to get 900. They'll go broke. If you watch that episode of Broke on ESPN, that's what they were talking about. It's a true competitive, me first, A-type mentality. So if you're going to get in with these athletes, you might want to research what you're getting into. But it was a sad story. I'm quite sure we're going to hear more in the weeks to come about this. We'll be back. More of the Sports Jock Show. 888-926-7562.
You could have got him a new one, though, G.
stop.
More of the Sports Jock Show with Wayne Gandy coming up next.
Psst. Hey, over here.
What?
Right here in the back.
Where?
Over by the fence.
You? The bike?
Yeah, the bike. Right in the grass where the kids left me a while ago. You know how lonely it is being left day after day, not being able to cruise the reservation?
Pardon me?
Remember when you got me for the kids? You told them, "No, you kids go have fun, enjoy the outdoors, and be careful."
Yeah?
I really miss it, especially when they put that playing card in my spokes and I made a really cool sound the faster we went. Well, could you get my tires a little air, dust off my seat, and remind the kids how fun I still am?
Okay. Oh, you are dusty.
Yeah, and I may need a couple of bolts tightened, too. Now let's go.
As Native American parents and caregivers, our encouragement to healthy lifestyles for our kids is helping them get outside and play. Get ideas, get involved, get going at letsmove.gov/Indian Country. Brought to you by USDA, HHS, and the Ad Council.
Hey, Dad, how do you throw a curveball?
How do you build a fort? How do refrigerators run? How do fish learn how to swim?
Kids ask a lot of questions.
How high can you jump?
But you don't have to know every answer.
How many phone numbers are there?
Because you don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent.
How do cell phones work?
There are thousands of children in foster care who don't need every question answered.
What's electricity?
They just need you.
What's the moon made of?
For more information on how you can adopt, go to AdoptUSKids.org. A public service announcement from the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, Adopt U.S. Kids, and the Ad Council.
And now, back to the sports job, Wayne Gandy.
Center Court on sports, news, gossip, blah, 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 blah.
Welcome back to the Sports Jock Show. I'm the Sports Jock, Wayne Gandy. Probably the biggest story before the Javon Belcher situation happened Saturday was the actions of head coach of the San Antonio Spurs, Coach Popovich, going into Miami on Thursday, sitting his three stars, not just sitting them, Manu Ginobili, Tony Parker, Tim Duncan, and even a reserve, Danny Green. He sent them back to San Antonio. So Pop went the full way in. Since then, the Spurs have been fined $250,000 for not bringing those players to Miami, a game that was on TNT that the Spurs, with 3 minutes to go, was leading by 6 points. That's how good the game still ended up being. Coach Popovich said that they had just played three games in four nights, and his team, the guys he sent home, were veterans and older. David Stern, the commissioner, said that because the coach did not inform the Heat, the media, you know, it makes it seem like, so I'm coaching a team, but I need to tell all of you what I'm doing, you know. But I just wanted to get my man, NBA.com, NBA TV. What you got your finger up over there for? Sekou Smith is on the line. Sekou, are you there?
Sekou.
No Sekou, I tell you. You think he on the phone? That's the bad producer for y'all that don't know. He's at it again. As I said weeks before, 888-926-7562. Fax me. Send me a pigeon. Isn't that what they used to do in the hotel?
Yes.
So we're trying to get Sake on the line. But until then, you know, I got this itch in my foot, man. It's driving me crazy. You know that itch inside? It feels like it's on the nerve. You don't know anything about that? Tall lady.
Yes, but not in the
foot.
Them
big old feet you have.
Not in the foot. Don't start. You know, I wear steel toes for a purpose.
Is that why?
Yes, I wear them for a purpose. Just so I can be ready just in case something pop off.
What's going to pop off?
No, wait, I might have put a steel toe somewhere.
You're 6'1". How tall are you anyway?
I am, you know what? Why do men diminish women's height, tall women, when they meet them? They always say, oh, you about 5'7". I was like, and that would make you 5'2".
But how tall are you?
I am 6 feet tall without my shoes.
Without your feet. Okay, 6 feet. A six-footer, that's what we usually refer to you as.
But everybody else swears I'm taller than that. But I have great posture.
I think we finally got Sekou on the line. Sekou, great. Are you there?
I'm here, man. Look, we're going to sanction Twitty if he can't do right with the connection.
Hey, man, if you got anybody over there, 12-year-old intern, anybody that you can send my way to handle this board for me, I would definitely appreciate. We were talking about the fine that the Spurs received this week from Popovich. It made big news, especially Thursday. I was watching the game. I've always liked the Spurs. Tim Duncan, best power forward ever play. Sorry to my friend Charles Barkley, but that is the truth. Did you think the NBA handled this right, Sekou?
No, I didn't think they did at all. I mean, I thought it was, I didn't think they should have sanctioned anybody. And I think a coach should be allowed to coach his team in whatever fashion he deems necessary. I understand this idea that there's an 8-year-old kid, you know, in Miami who saved up all his money out of his piggy bank you know, to come to the game and see the Spurs and this, that, and the other. And that sounds cute, but, you know, as well as I do, the seats in the lower bowl at every arena in the league are corporate seats usually, or high rollers. And the people who sit down there courtside in the first few rows, they can afford to go watch the Spurs in San Antonio if they want to. So, it's not about the fans. If it was about the fans, tickets wouldn't cost so much, right. You know, and you wouldn't have to take out a second mortgage to take a family of five to any sporting event, you know, pro sporting event. So it's not about the fans. It's about the TV partners, of which I work for one. So, I mean, I understand that side of it. But, again, you either let your coach handle his business and do what he does and stay out of his way, or you don't. And it's a slippery slope the league is going down, finding the Spurs the way they did and coming out, you know, with the stance that they did, because now you leave every other instance where players are being held out up to the same interpretation. And you know, if I'm the Spurs, I'm not paying that fine. We got to fight over that one.
And when you look at the situation, like I said, in the game, the Spurs was winning by 6 with 3 minutes to go. So when you look at the game, David Stern before the game said there was going to be some sanctions and fines before the game was even played. I could have even understood it if it was a blowout, but it was still a great game.
Yes.
And then he still went and fined the Spurs $250,000, which is just crazy. And I'm like you, Sekou. Be honest, when Dwayne Wade and LeBron is on the court, does it matter who the other team is?
Yeah, I mean, we always hear about people saying they don't like watching the Spurs anyway, right?
Right, they're so boring. Yes.
There's no drama. I mean, my big problem with it, though, is, again, impugning the professionalism of those guys who did play, man. You basically saying, you're yelling them a bunch of, you know, bench warmers and towel holders, and, you know, if they play and yell, that means this game is lost.
Right.
And those guys went out to me, and they eradicated whatever fine or sanction was coming. I was in the game, man. And I was on Twitter clowning around. You know, if I was Popovich in the so-called scrims, it wasn't that game. That post-game interview with Craig Sager would have been explosive. I'm talking about, I would have went up there and clowned if I was Greg Popovich and they'd won that game. if you're the league, you are treading on very, very strange territory by doing what you did, because not only did you find them, but I mean, you find them $250,000. I mean, that's a staggering amount of money to find somebody for something like that.
And a lot of people didn't know, and correct me if I'm wrong, the Heat hadn't played since Saturday, so it was Thursday. They had like 5 days off. And in that same 5 days, the Spurs had like 3 or 4 games. How did you schedule that? How do you schedule where the team I'm going to go play almost has been out for a week? And you sent me on a road trip that I was on my 4th game in 5 nights against a fresh Miami Heat team. So how competitive did you really want the game to be anyway?
Exactly. And Popovich mentioned when the schedule came out that he was going to give his guys a rest somewhere in that stretch. I mean, it wasn't like it was a stunner that he decided to hold him out. Now, the fact that he took all 4 of those guys out and sent them home, I think is what really, you know, upset some people. But again, man, look, the Spurs are a championship-caliber franchise for a reason. And those guys who came off that bench and went after the Heat the way they did showed you why.
Yeah, because you got to have that kind of bench play to win a championship. A lot of teams are finding that out across the league. Kobe Bryant calling out Paul Gasol, put on your big boy pants, he says, and stop whining. How bad is this story going to get out in L.A.?
Well, I mean, it's hard to get much worse than things have been in L.A., you know, since the Mike Brown got fired. I don't think this one is as big a deal because Kobe has poked Gasol in the past, and, you know, Phil Jackson bumped him in his chest one time in the playoffs. I mean, there have been some issues with motivation and Paul Gasol in the past. The thing that's going to really make this difficult to manage, I think, for a lot of people is how much of this becomes a Mike D'Antoni versus Paul Gasol thing, and then what do you do with Paul Gasol if you can't trade him, and if he's not going to be a part of this thing in the fourth quarter of games, and you got one of your best players, a guy you're paying a handsome, you know, sum to over the next couple of years, then you really have to wonder where the rubber is going to meet the road in this situation. And I have to believe that when Kobe's coming out and talking like this publicly about Paul Gasol, Kobe is trying to head that off himself. You know, he's trying to get in the middle of what could turn out to be something a lot worse between the head coach and one of these players. And Paul Gasol is not the same Paul Gasol he was 45 years ago. He's 32 years old. He's got knee issues. He's played a ton of basketball. When you consider how deep the Lakers have played into the playoffs in the last 5 years, and his international competition with Spain. So, I mean, he's battling some very real demons right now. Age, you know, fatigue, same things a lot of other guys are battling, but he was never the most athletic seven-footer to begin with. It's not like we're talking about a guy who was in Dwight Howard's athletic category. So, right. You have to be very careful poking players in public. Kobe, of course, is a guy who's done it before and has no problems wearing the black hat. So that might save a little bit of the drama, but I see it getting worse before it gets better for Powell and the Lakers.
And it seems like when those initial trade talks started maybe 2 years ago with Paul Gasol being on the trading block, it seems like that since then it's been a different Paul Gasol on the court. Real quick before we go, Sekou Smith, just real quick, tell us, when is Andrew Bynum going to ever suit up again?
Well, I mean, as soon as he gives Clarence Williams III his Halloween costume back, if I see that hairdo or one of these outfits one more time, man, I'm going to turn Purple Rain on in my DVD player and compare it. But, I mean, listen, the Sixers took a risk acquiring Andrew Bynum, and I talked to Mitch Kupchak, the Lakers GM, a couple weeks ago on my podcast, and he said it. He said, we had a chance to get the best center in the league, and we felt Andrew was the second best. And he's proven to everybody right now that those conversations about he and Dwight Howard and how they compare are ridiculous. Dwight, even coming off back surgery, is going out and putting up his usual numbers and playing at a high level, even though the Lakers aren't winning right now. Andrew Bynum is chilling in a vest and jeans on the bench, man.
Right.
And if he's not careful, that's going to be the lasting memory anybody has of him in Philadelphia, because you get too much further along in the season, it won't make sense to bring him back. He's not going to help that team do anything if he's out there playing half the time and playing half-hearted the way he did a lot of times when he was with the Lakers.
Thank you, Sekou, for calling in. Sekou Smith, NBA.com, NBA TV, always informative. We'll be back with more of the Sports Jock Show right after this.
Oops, 888-926-7562.
More of the Sports Jock Show with Wayne Gandy coming up next.
The odds of a young girl being discovered by an industry insider while singing to herself pumping gas? 1 in 300 million. The odds of the daughter of a clergyman from Severn, Maryland spending 11 weeks at number one on the U.S. singles charts? 1 in 19 million. The odds of going on to win 6 Grammy Awards? 1 in 1.4 million. The odds of selling over 40 million records? 1 in 800,000. The odds of this musician and performer having a child diagnosed with autism? 1 in 110. I'm Toni Braxton, and I encourage you to learn the signs of autism at autismspeaks.org. Early diagnosis can make a lifetime of difference. Autism Speaks. It's time to listen. Brought to you by Autism Speaks and the Ad Council.
While cutting molding with a 12-inch dual compound miter saw, while holding a newborn baby in your arms, when face-to-face with a congregation of alligators, with the ball in your hands and the entire freaking season on the line.
There are a million places you'd never consider texting, so why would you do it while driving? NASCAR driver Casey Kane here, asking you to please stop the text, and together we can stop the wrecks.
Brought to you by the Ad Council and the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration. Get the message at StopTextStopWrecks.org.
And now, back to the Sports Jot, Wayne Gandy.
Welcome back to the Sports Jock Show. I'm the Sports Jock, Wayne Gandy. We'd like to thank Sekou Smith for calling in, NBA.com, NBA TV. I do see this Laker thing getting worse before it gets better. We're not 2 months into the season and they're throwing each other under the bus, changing coaches. There's just a lot going on out in LA. Speaking of NBA, the greatest NBA player in a lot of people's minds, or at least in the last 25 years, Michael Jordan was in the news last week. He has been banned from a Miami Beach golf course. The name of the beach, the course, has not been put out, but he did not adhere to the dress code. They say he was out golfing and he was wearing cargo pants, and in this particular place, you can't wear cargo pants.
You must
pants.
Wear your classic, you have to classic golf attire. That is not proper.
You got to have your proper gear on. They say you can wear shorts, but cargo pants were illegal. The members complained. The haters, man. It's just haters anywhere. I mean, how are we on the golf course on a beach in Miami, and you're worried about what the other man has on?
Sports jock, Michael Jordan's my guy, but he was wrong.
But cargo pants, he's wrong?
He's wrong, G, because, you know, it started back in the day.
You're the tennis. I mean, you're the golf guy. Yeah. So educate us non-golf people.
Well, here it is. It's an etiquette, and it's ways you do things. And when you go out there, you golf, gentlemen only, ladies forbidden. That's what G-O-L-F stands for. Just to let you know.
Nah, I don't care.
Anyway, and it's a gentleman's game.
Swing your little stick.
So you, when you when you're out there, you want to have on your slacks. You want to look good. You want to have your shoes. You know, you have them clean. That's why we have shoe shine guys in the clubhouse. You want to have everything pressed on. You want to look real good. I mean, it's basically golf is. You're out there interviewing a lot of times, doing a lot of business and everything else. Michael feels I have a deep pockets. I could go and do this. Because when Michael comes here, there's a couple of very exclusive private courses he plays at. They let him play 6 to 8 at a time because they're gambling. They got so much money going on. But anybody else like me or you want to go and play, no, you can't play no more than 4. So, but Michael, he gets that privileges at a lot of places, and he's been doing that over the years. And so I guess
on this course, he did say, his representatives did say that he had played in these style pants before, and they hadn't said anything. So how does that work?
Well, see, that's the thing with private country clubs. When you have members, the members pretty much, when they pay their dues, they pay that initiation fee anywhere from most private courses, a good exclusive private courses, anywhere from $50,000 to $150,000. That's just the initiation. That's not even including your monthly bill. It can run from anywhere from $1,000 to $2,500 a month with your golf and dinner and everything else and entertaining. But apparently the day that Mr. Jordan probably went, he went on a day where one of the two or three of the members who have just as much deep pockets or who are always in the pro's ear about any and everybody, why is that person on the range with a t-shirt on? Why is that person down here? Why is this person not have slacks? Why is this and that?
Right.
So you have these type of people. And he just, as the head pro director of golf, yes, happy Michael Jordan is here, but if you want to keep your job, you go out there and you go ask Mr. Jordan to leave.
Okay. Well, they say he was on the 12th hole by the time they addressed him.
And
at that point,
it didn't matter.
He kept playing. He figured he had 6 holes left. And he was not going back to the clubhouse but it has to be a great marketing tool to be able to say that Michael Jordan is a member and playing your golf course, right?
Gee, you know how many guys I get that I know have told me in the past, you don't even play golf. NFL guys, come on, say, hey, Tweet, let's go play some golf. Just tell them I'm a former NFL player, and they'll get us on. And there's some people, golf course, who fall for it or whatever. They fall, whatever. But they're always looking for. And then guys like myself or other guys who are in the business will say, man, you got enough money to pay for everybody's round. Prime example, not former NFL, Major League Baseball player. He came to me. Came to our course, didn't have a membership, but I allowed him to still come on because he knew somebody. He talked to me, but when I charged him and Steve Howell and two other guys full rate, he looked at me like, hey, don't you know who I am? I'm like, yeah, but you're still going to pay.
Okay, okay. So that's when the non-player gets to poke his chest at the real guy.
Nah, it ain't Pokemon. That person, he can't beat me, so it doesn't matter. So you know, like, we could have went, like the, we could have went like out the there and play. He could have went out there and played me for his money back.
You're like the doorman at the club, then. Oh, you know how the doorman at the club get a little power? Now you want to act like an A and an
Can
S.
Can I shine your shoes there, boss?
Well, Michael Jordan, I guess you will have to find you another Miami Beach resort. Or
Mike
just buy, you,
Mike
just buy you one.
He knows better.
You got enough money. Why don't you just buy you one?
Can you bring the tricked out golf cart?
Nah, you can't go. Mike,
can you bring
Mike
the one with
better.
The booming system?
Mike knows Mike knows better. He knows.
Golf all wrong.
Yeah, golf all wrong. Can you bring the cart with the system and the rims on it? Is that a problem? Seriously, because people are driving all over.
See, when he go to Augusta, you ask Michael Jordan is dressed to the T.
Okay. Well, he was at the Ryder Cup in some kind of crazy outfit earlier this year.
Well, he was chilling with George Bush. That was, you know, that's something.
That's a different
on that presidential.
Well, we'll see if the next course Mike do in Miami. You got to find out the name of the place, too, that they threw him out of.
Oh, it's the Miami Country Club.
Oh, it's Miami Country Club. So, boycott the Miami Country Club.
No, Michael Jordan knows
we'll be
better.
Back.
He goes to a public
show.
Course. He wants to do that.
888-926-7562. You're a shooting star, I see. A vision of ecstasy. When you hold me,
I'm alive. We're like diamonds. More of the Sports Jock Show with Wayne Gandy coming up next.
So, Jacqueline.
Yes, Mom?
I wanted to talk to you about something, and... Oh, wait. Hold on. I just got a text. Oh, there's another one. Wow. Busy, busy me. So, anyway...
Oh, wait, Mom. I just got a message. My friends keep commenting on my comment. Oh, there's another one. So many comments on my comment.
Oh, I can't wait to watch TV tonight. Playoffs!
Hey, guys, check out my new video game. Pew, pew!
Wait.
Mom, what?
Huh? What? Hold
What'd
on.
You say?
Wait a second, what?
This weekend,